She won the Elliott Black Award, which is an award given by the American Ethical Union for someone who really puts their values and their lives on the line. Dr. Piven has been a consistent proponent of peace and justice, from her efforts against the Vietnam War to her analysis of the destructive effects of military interventions. She has been vilified and targeted by those whose mission is to destroy progressive changes. She led academic and activist opposition for reforms that resulted in a major reduction in extreme poverty. She was one of the founders of Human Serve, an organization that promoted voter registration by citizens when they applied for various government benefits or for driver's licenses. In time, this approach was incorporated into the National Voter Registration Act. I could go on and on, but I would much prefer, as I know you would, to hear Dr. Piven speak herself. And if you haven't yet bought this, this is a wonderful book. This is Who's Afraid of Frances Fox Piven? The Essential Writings of the Professor Glenn Beck Loves to Hate. Thank you, Glenn Beck, for bringing Frances Fox Piven back in the public eye, where she belongs, and back to our auditorium and our meeting house. Here she is.
Thank you, Anne. I'm really glad to be back. I've spoken several times to Ethical Culture over, I think, the last 4 decades. It's a long time. But this is an especially important, and for me, and I think for you too, a happy moment to reflect on American politics. And the subject I'm going to talk about today is the new movement, the new protest movement that has emerged in American society that we call Occupation Wall Street. I want to say a little bit about the conditions. I'll tell you, I wake up happy every day. And I'm so busy, and I'm working so hard. And I feel so good. I feel as though we have a chance to recover our country and to save the world. And it's because there is this new protest movement that has burst forth in the United States, the most powerful country in the world, and a dangerous country as well. So, today, well, you all know that, I'm sure, that protest movements have always been very important in American political history. In a way, bringing us back to our core values of justice, equality, and democracy. Because if there is no protest, then the dynamics set in motion by American business, American capitalism, grow larger and larger and more destructive. And in a way, it's the emergence of protest, the abolitionists, the progressives, the labor movement, the black freedom movement, that set us back on a reasonable and humane course. Well, that's what Occupation Wall Street seems to be doing. So, let me say a little bit about the conditions which gave rise to this protest movement. I'll just be very quick because I know you know those conditions. For over 40 years, since the 1970s, once the Black Freedom Movement and the anti-war movement and even the women's movement and the gay and lesbian movement subsided, calmed down, American business has been mobilizing to reclaim a bigger share of American wealth and to do it by controlling American government on all levels. Now, this mobilization wasn't exactly a secret. They did it by forming new organizations. You've heard of some of these organizations, the Business Roundtable, ALEC, that operates in the state legislature. They formed new think tanks. You've heard of those, Heritage, Cato, the American Enterprise Institute. They had organized new lobbying capacities. You know, before this business mobilization in the 1970s, Washington, D.C. was a kind of sleepy town. I remember it before K Street. Some of you may remember it before K Street. But after the early 1970s, every major corporation in the United States decided they had to have a presence in Washington, and it was a lobbying presence through which they would pour money into American politics, the money that polluted our politics, that destroyed our safety net, that eviscerated our regulations of finance, because finance was regulated after the 1930s, that weakened labor protections, that weakened environmental protections. And all of a sudden, Washington, D.C. looked a little bit like Manhattan, with all of its gleaming glass towers, which housed public relations people and lobbyists. Well, the agenda of this business mobilization to dominate American politics was pretty clear. They wanted to slash taxes on the wealthy and on corporations. You know, when we came out of World War II, the highest marginal tax rate was 91%. Even through the 1950s, it was 70%. But the relentless pressure of business has resulted in a tax system in which a lot of corporations pay no taxes at all, and a lot of the very wealthy pay at the capital gains rate of 15%. And then they say, we all have to tighten our belts because there is no public money. There are no revenues. Of course there are no revenues. They're not paying any revenues into public coffers. They wanted to roll back labor. The labor victories of the 1930s meant that workers wanting to form unions had the protection of a government agency and of public laws. Well, they changed a lot of those laws. And they so intimidated and corrupted the National Labor Relations Board that unions could not make any progress. They were continually being rolled back, partly as a result of the decisions, the unfavorable decisions of the National Labor Relations Board. Well, the result in turn of that was that wages did not keep pace with inflation. A larger and larger share of American income and wealth was drifting upward in the class structure. We were becoming more and more unequal. We are one of the most unequal countries in the world today. Poverty has increased. And our public sector has been depleted. I mean, you know that. You know that our trains don't run very well. You know that our streets are full of potholes. You know that public sector workers have been under attack. They cry that school teachers and firemen are the new rich, that they're overpaid. And they attack their pensions, they attack their public sector bargaining rights. Well, and that depletes us all as a society. So that one trend that was occurring in the background, it began in the 1970s and it has continued relentlessly through right now. But there's something else that has been happening that helps account for the rise of this new protest movement. And that is, well, our politics has been very propagandistic. And, you know, it is very difficult to unravel what is occurring in the American political economy. It's terribly complicated. It's complicated for academics. That's why they can continue to have so many arguments with each other. It's hard to figure out how public policy, which is supposed to be democratic, how public policy affects what's going on in the economy. And given that complexity and mystification, people are very susceptible to propaganda. And with the concentration of wealth and the increasing focus of big business and finance on politics, a kind of deliberate effort to form a machine, a propaganda machine, increased and expanded. And that's what it should be called, a propaganda machine. Everybody has to, all the instruments in that machine have to be on message. They took over, they intimidated the mainstream media by calling them pink until they stopped being any other color, but I don't know, blue. They created Fox News, which now has more listeners than any of the other mainstream media. They created new magazines. They even infiltrated the universities by paying for seminars of honored lecturers. And the message was relentless that the problem with the United States was big government. And if that was the problem, then it made sense to roll back regulations on finance. If that was the problem, maybe it made sense to roll back limits on pollution. If the problem was big government, maybe it made sense to weaken protections for labor or protections for the poor. Well, you know, a lot of people working 2-3 jobs, they don't have the technical capacity to penetrate the legislation and regulations. Do you understand those credit default swaps? Really? And so it was that the organized right, which was the sort of protector, defender, proselytizer for the business agenda, grew in the United States until the crash, the financial crash, until the Great Recession that began in 2007. What began to happen in 2007 was a kind of epiphany where some of the irresponsibility and some of the criminality of the major actors in the American political economy suddenly became visible, suddenly was exposed. A lot of tales were told, for example, not only of Bernie Madoff, but do you know how many times Goldman Sachs has been hauled before the Securities Exchange Commission? We began to hear these stories of manipulation and crime in the highest purchase of our economy on Wall Street. We also knew after 2008 that some of these very actors, the manipulators, the cheats, who were running the financial system, were taking billions and billions of dollars in government bailouts. They were using a kind of blackmail of financial collapse to take all of this taxpayer money. And so did some companies like General Motors, for example. Everybody was watching this. It could not be hidden. And then we we came to a point in time where Wall Street profits were restored. The stock market was doing fine. General Motors was doing okay. They were paying big bonuses to their executives. But wages in the United States continued to fall. Unions continued to lose ground. The poverty rate continued to increase. Millions and millions of people who had their life savings in little houses discovered that their mortgages were underwater and that they were at risk of losing their homes. And the banks refused to reduce the principal that they owed to its current market value. Students, millions of them, were graduating from college, which was supposed to be that you really had a chance at the American dream. They were graduating from college with debt levels of $50,000, $80,000, $125,000, and they could not find jobs. 14 million people are unemployed in the United States. But the stock market was doing okay. The contradiction between the basic economic and social trends that were set in motion by the business takeover of American politics on the one hand, and what was exposed as a result of the financial crisis, created what you might call a crisis of legitimacy. The people who are in the driver's seat in the American political economy are not accountable to we, the people, the citizens of our democracy. I think that those were the basic conditions for a huge protest movement, the kind of protest movement that has at earlier moments in American history set us on track again, helped us to recover from the jungle-like conditions that can be created by an unrestrained capitalist economy. And so I waited, you waited, lots of us waited. Where is that protest movement? We need it. And then, in mid-September, there was this story. It wasn't widely blasted out. There was this story about an occupation of a little park four blocks north of Wall Street. It was called Zuccotti Park, renamed its old name Liberty Plaza. And I know there were a few hundred, maybe 700 at most, people occupying that park, and they had a slogan. And the slogan was, "We are the 99%. We're occupying Wall Street because Wall Street represents the 1%, the people who have gathered the wealth and income of the United States and put it into their own pockets." That's what they said. But there were only a few hundred of them. Who cares? The press went down to have a look. They reported back that they're wearing these funky clothes, the press told us, and they don't have a program. They don't have any demands. And they have drummers, too. So at the beginning, the press was very disdainful. This protest is a little bit different than other protests. One way in which it was different was they said, "Occupy." They didn't say, "We're organizing another march on Washington." Marches, you know, they're nice. We know that when we have a march with banners, placards, we know that then there's a movement. And we're forever marching on Washington. It's fun. We see our friends there. And the authorities don't much mind either, because they know the march is going to be over by the time night falls. Everybody will go home. A lot of energy will have been dissipated in organizing the march. If it's raining, more energy will have been dissipated. Marches and rallies are like that. They occur, they give us a thrill, they lift our morale, and then they're over. But these people said, we're staying. And they started out kind of small. But they said we're staying, and they stayed. Nobody knew how long they were going to stay. 3 days, 3 weeks, 3 months, 3 years. And news began to percolate about similar occupations in other cities. Also small. I've been to a number of those occupations. They're not huge, but everybody's saying, we're staying. Everybody has the same slogan, Occupy Wall Street. It resonates. So many people know that Wall Street is in the driver's seat, that financial capitalism, its irresponsible speculation, is a large part of our problem. And they said, we are the 99%. You know, I was with a lot of those Occupy Wall Street people at a retreat over the weekend, and I was laughing because I said to them, if you had asked me, I would have advised you to say, we are the 90%, because that's more accurate. And I laughed at myself, because their slogan is so much better. We are the 99%. And we are the 99% was a slogan which encouraged them to reach out and embrace virtually everybody in American society under their banner. And sure enough, as time passed, not only were there more occupations, but other groups started to rally and to march down to the occupation in New York City. The occupiers invited the New York unions to come down, and they did. Now, some of you will have the kind of historical memory that I have, and you will know how unusual it is for young, countercultural, funky people to reach out to unions. They don't do that. There's a divide. No, but these young people have no idea how nice they are. They invited the unions down, and the unions came. They invited the air pilots down, and the air pilots came. They invited Marine veterans down, and Marines came. And why did they come? They came because Occupy Wall Street. Wall Street resonated as a target. We are the 99% against the 1%. That resonated as an analysis. So, incredibly, over a period of just 2 months, this movement, largely of the young, but we're welcome down there. You can go down there and they'll be very nice. They'll share their food with you and make you feel part of the movement. Well, I really don't know why this unusual action, occupying a park near Wall Street, was the spark that resonated with so many people. You know, that's kind of a magical moment. I can't figure that out. There's always a spark. Rosa Parks is said to be the spark for the civil rights movement. Now, Rosa Parks had actually refused to go to the back of the bus before. But this time, it sparked a movement. And that movement has had the incredible effect of cutting through the propaganda. The propaganda that says, well, if we cut taxes on corporations or on the rich, it'll be bad for the economy. It's harder to say that now. The propaganda that says if we extend unemployment insurance or fund a jobs bill, it will be bad for the economy. That kind of argument, which we were all aghast at the fact that everybody was sort of dazed by those arguments. Now that those arguments have lost some of their traction, and that's a huge accomplishment. It will change the 2012 election. The Democrats, who are weak after all, the Democrats will be unable to avoid the issue of extreme inequality, of injustice in the United States. But more than that, I think the movement is now at a new phase. Its communicative power has been magical. They are so good at it. Their symbolism is so dramatic, so good. And their internal processes, which are enough, I mean, it could make you cry to think of all the meetings that they have in order to operate in the intensely democratic way that they insist on operating. But as long as I don't have to be in those meetings, I want to congratulate them for making it work. They're making it work. They really are. The principle is horizontalism. And you know, I have heard old union guys explain to each other what horizontalism means. And everybody's learning to do this, or this, or this. That's how you participate in the meeting. This means, yes, I agree. This means, well, I'm not sure. This means, no, 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 no. And the people's mic, I've spoken using the people's mic quite a few times recently at different occupations. And it's, you know, it came into being because Bloomberg denied them any amplification equipment. Oh, that mayor of ours. He's got to go. The billionaire mayor of New York City. You know, New York City used to be a kind of pioneer in the United States of decent public policies. We had this great public health system where all poor children could get care. We had the best public housing in the country. In the 1960s, our welfare system covered almost all the poor in the city. And now we have a billionaire mayor whose main agenda is building glass towers to house the financiers on Wall Street and all of their hangers-on. And who has been absolutely tone deaf to occupy Wall Street. Anyway, let's move on, because we're in a new phase. And I think Occupy Wall Street knows it's in a new phase. It knows it has to reach out to more people, that it has to move out from the little plazas and parks that it is occupying. And both encourage and participate in other kinds of political protests, whether they be strikes or resistance to evictions that follow on foreclosures. It has to engage more of the poor, and it has to engage more of us. Because what I really want to leave you with is the sense that we are all part of this movement. The movement needs all of us. There is work to be done by people of faith. There is work to be done by the elders who have joined Occupy. There is work to be done by the unions, and the unions know it. There is work to be done by the numerous NGOs who are involved in social services. We especially need the poor, to recover some of their morale. Poor people in the United States have been exposed to 40 years of shaming. No wonder they're not at the lead in this protest, but they need to be embraced by this protest movement, to link arms with it. But most especially, they need us, because we are here. And if you're at all like me, if you have any of my political experience and my commitment to democratic reform in the United States, you will find the ways that you can become part of Occupy Wall Street. Thank you.
Thank you.